Hello, and welcome to Gilmore's Glorious Gossip, a show dedicated to Critical Role over on the Geek & Sundry Twitch channel. This week features two more amazing artists. I gotta tell you guys, we are loving the art coming out of the Critters community.
So good.
There's really far too much to choose from. We only choose two, but that's because recently we haven't been getting requests from people saying, hey, can you feature our art? Please, yeah. Don't be shy. Let us know. We love seeing the art. We love sharing the art. So,
throw it at us.
Indeed. The current art that you're seeing is from Jade Pines, known as @phaselocks. That's PhaseLocs over on Twitter. Later, you'll be seeing a piece from Rena, known as @VLUSCINIAS. And I apologize, I'm not even going to try pronouncing that, because I will butcher it.
Luskinius?
I guess. I like I said, I don't want to try butchering it.
I'm sorry if I did.
But yeah, seriously guys, if you'd like your art featured here, let any of the show's hosts know via Twitter. We'll do our best to get it on the show. Don't forget to like and subscribe so you can catch us every Monday. My name's Akiva, found on Twitter @AKIVADAPHYDD. And joining me today is my excellent friend Kat. Go ahead and introduce yourself, and let's see what you remember of your first tabletop RPG experience.
Oh my gosh, I don't think we want to... Okay, yeah. My name's Kat, guys. You can find me at Kittens Mitten G on Twitter. That's KITTENSMITTENG on Twitter. My first tabletop experience was actually quite scary because we decided to go to one of those like dice shops, like shops that
a gaming shop,
but this particular shop we were told to go to was kind of like in an alley on a street that was very scary and it was dark at night.
Those are often the best ones, though.
Oh my gosh. For someone who was brand new to the whole scene and experience, we kind of walked in, we're like, are we safe here? Like, is this... And then we said, we heard there's Dungeons and Dragons on tonight, can we jump in? And they're like, yeah. He said, just go around the side, up the stairs, and it's like in a back room up there. And so we went around the side of this shop, and it was dimly lit, and it was really quiet, and the stairs kind of creaked as we walked up them. And I just looked at my husband, I'm like, oh my god, we're going to get mugged, like, we're going to get jumped. it was just the strangest experience, but it was really good. They were very accommodating and really nice people, and kind of showed us the ropes, and we went from there, but it was scary for a moment, yeah. How about you?
I believe it. Mine was a little more friendly. I was 12 at the time and in Boy Scouts. And we were all prepped to go out camping and all that, but we were waiting for everybody else to show up. And we were about 2 hours early. And it was just me, my brother, two of the other scouts. And one of the older boys... you know, had experience with D&D, and so he just did a quick one-shot, made up some characters for us, and taught us the ropes, but this was back in AD&D, so we were learning Thaco and everything.
That's but really cool.
Let me just say, I am so glad that I didn't start DMing until 3rd edition, 3.5. And now in 5th edition, because it is so streamlined.
Yes.
Like, we did one encounter for that entire 2 hours.
Oh my god. Is it just like all the modifiers and everything? Was that...
All the modifiers, all the stacking numbers.
Yeah.
The math. Like, D&D back then was a game of math. Like, math may be a basis for 5th edition. 2nd edition... you lived and breathed math, but...
Oh, wow.
That's okay.
I would have hated it.
So we have a lot to talk about, so let's go ahead and jump on in. So the game picks up in the evening in, you know, in the pirate tribe. Maybe a few minutes after they finish closing the rift in last episode. The Ashari members of the pirate tribe are starting to rebuild out of the stone, you know, just getting some shelter for the night. Scanlan pops up and asks if the Ashari will be comfortable. And he offers some quote-unquote slightly better shelter with his quote-unquote magical dalliance, which everybody takes to be a penis joke, of course, because it's Scanlan.
Of course, it's Scanlan, yes.
But then he surprises everybody by casting Mordenkainen's Magnificent Mansion.
Oh, this is amazing.
Yes, and he does so by singing a parody of Brick House. But looking up the specific spell, it is a 7th level spell, meaning Scanlan leveled up last game.
Woo!
Yes, congratulations.
Yay!
The duration of the spell is 24 hours. It takes about 10 minutes to cast. There is only one entrance to this mansion, and it's only usable by those who are designated by the caster.
Yeah.
The mansion itself is 50 cubes, with each cube being 10 feet on a side. 10 by 10 is what it says on the book. It does not give a height limit, so, you know, obviously Matt played with that a bit in the episode.
Yeah.
There's enough food for a 9-course banquet for up to 100 people. So much food. It's staffed by 100 completely obedient ethereal servants. They can do anything a normal human can do, but they cannot attack or cause harm. When the spell ends, if there are any creatures that were not created by the spell, any creatures inside the mansion are expelled out into the nearest open space near the entrance.
Yeah.
The group has a little debate on how many people can enter. Scanlan's kind of hesitant about letting in quote-unquote riffraff. Taliesin looks at Matt and asks, are any of the Pyra hot? To which Laura and Travis, of course, pick up immediately on the puns. They're all hot. Travis says, it's the fire plane. Catching the drift of what Taliesin was saying, was meaning, though, Matt says, sure. So Percy turns to Scanlan and appeals to his libido, something that never fails.
Yes. They know each other too well by this point.
Oh, indeed. So Scanlan relents and announces the invitation, but is summarily ignored by the Ashari. Vex grows a little impatient, so she goes ahead and enters. Scanlan follows in and explains the layout. Sleeping rooms are upstairs. They've got a game room and a kitchen and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
Then Grog enters, and he thinks the attendants are ghosts. And after his experiences with ghosts, he doesn't take any chances, and he just kills 3 of the attendants.
Oh, Grog. So reliable.
Yes. But, you know, better safe than sorry.
Oh, true. True.
Scanlan takes a few seconds to explain the servants, to which Vex questions, do you pay them? Scanlan replies, well, they're slave ghosts. Vex says, that's horrible. And Scanlan says, no, they like it. And so to demonstrate, he orders one of them to braid his chest hair.
And I love how at this point, Matt actually starts braiding.
In like, midair, yes.
In midair. So particular.
And he's so proper about it, too.
He is. It's like he's done it before.
I think he has. Maybe he's practiced on Marisha. Maybe he has some nieces and nephews. I don't know his family situation. So.
Yeah.
But while the braiding is going on, Scanlan asks, "Do you like this job?" And the servant says, "It is my purpose, master." Vex responds questioningly, "Do you enjoy your purpose?" To which the servant responds, again very properly, "What is one but to enjoy one's purpose in life?" At that point, Grog requests the most expensive ale they have in the house. And then Vax pops up. "How? Have you always been able to do this? Have you been holding out on us?" Scanlan replies, "It never occurred to me to do this before for some reason." Grog gets the bright idea, realizing how many servants are in this place. "You shouldn't be Burt Reynolds. You should be Hugh Hefner from now on." And I would be saying Scanlan. Oh yeah, I would not be surprised if in some future game Scanlan makes a callback to that by introducing himself as Hugh Hefner.
Hugh Hefner. Oh no.
But Scanlan laughs and says, "No, this is a new skill set I've just learned. I wouldn't hold out on you. I'm still designing it. You'll see in the dining room a portrait of me. Not the one I had commissioned, but one of me I recently envisioned. It's me in a smoking jacket, standing before a fireplace with another portrait of me in a smoking jacket above it, Stephen Colbert style."
I love it.
And you know, he goes into further explanation about the rooms. And I just want to say, there aren't enough people that are familiar with Stephen Colbert, because I saw a number of people in the Geek and Sundry chat asking who Stephen Colbert was.
Oh.
He is hilarious. If you guys haven't seen him, Google him. Is he available in Australia, Kat?
I don't think that I have that kind of connection, Akiva. I could try.
well, no. I mean, you don't have to look it up right now. Country.
I'll have a look. I'll just Google him quickly, and yeah, he's familiar. Looks familiar, but
okay.
I don't know him that well. But I love that image. It actually reminded me of Sherlock Holmes. You know, kind of like a smoking jacket kind of Sherlock Holmes feel to it. But
yes, Stephen Colbert did that little portrait. He's part of it. He does comedy news. Like, he actually reports news, but he does it in a comedic way.
Right. I've probably seen some of his stuff. He looks familiar.
Oh, he's been everywhere. So if you've seen American TV or American commercials, you've probably seen him.
Okay.
But yeah, he did that because he was poking fun at the quote-unquote upper class. So.
Yeah.
But yes, enough on that, because this, like I said, is a long episode. So Vex, you know, pops in after hearing about how the bedrooms are set up. Vex asks, "You built this castle, Scanlan. How do we know you didn't put in creepy spy holes?" To which Scanlan just ignores the question.
Fair question.
Very fair question. But Scanlan ignores it. And Taliesin gets meta. He says, "Let's grab some beer, grab some dice, and some paper." You know, hinting at playing D&D within D&D. And so, you know, of course the cast starts going and making Inception jokes. If you haven't seen the movie, it's kind of confusing.
I like that movie. I'm not saying it's bad.
I'm just saying it's
so confusing. Yeah, I agree. I would have loved to have seen it. Like, them actually going down, setting out their paper.
Oh, yeah. Pausing the campaign so that they could have a one shot within the game.
Yeah, wouldn't that be amazing?
Taliesin, you know, pops up. "It's called Meta and Dragons. Let's see how deep it goes." Marisha pops.
So deep.
Oh yeah, don't go more than six layers.
Oh no.
Marisha replies that Keyleth gets a nosebleed for no reason and she's not sure why. Matt throws in that there's an ever-spinning top on the banister. At this point, Grog's ale is delivered, and while the servant is holding it, it's sort of an ethereal, almost see-through. But as soon as Grog touches it, it pops into physical reality, and it is the most amazing thing that Grog has tasted. Grog, throws a high five to the servant, and then is surprised by the actual contact. Then for a brief few seconds, there's implications of maturity within the stream. As Grog asks, the servants will do anything you want. And Laura, picking up on it, immediately says, as Vex, "What? That's terrible." Scanlan just says, "I'm way ahead of you, Grog. I've got 50 servants that are assigned to me. The rest are available to the rest of you in any capacity you need."
That's so wrong.
Keyleth decides that she's going to go out to bring in the other Ashari. Excuse me. So she's, has the servants gather up a plate of food. But as she's starting to take it out, it disappears right at the doorway. So instead she resorts to just words and says, "Hey guys, let's take the night off. You deserve a break." Vex continues asking about the room. Scanlan further describes the layout, where the bedrooms are located and such, and his is at the end of the hall, and there are two rooms next to his that are reserved. One is for Pike, and one is for Kaylee if she ever decides to join. I thought that was kind of sweet.
That was so touching, yeah. And everyone was like, "Ooh, that's a bit weird." But
yeah, but then again, they are Scanlan's best friends. So
I know.
They have to give him a hard time.
Weird. It's so cute, but yeah, it's great to see Scanlan taking a bit more of a serious side every now and then. Now I'm loving that.
Oh yeah, and I think it's great because he's not overplaying it. He's giving Kaylee the room that she needs, praying that she's safe, and is worried about her, and showing that worry by having a safe place for her.
Yeah, I love it. Beautiful.
Keyleth comes on in, and a few of the Pyra come in with her. And at that point, Vex asks for clarification on how safe this place is. And if you remember in the description I mentioned, only those designated can open the door.
Yeah, it's a pretty good spell.
Now, the cool thing is, if you set it up in advance and have a battle nearby, if you need to retreat,
yeah,
you can open the door if you are within 30 feet of it. You don't have to touch the door. You just have to be within 30 feet of it.
Oh, so that's interesting.
Great little escape route.
Nice.
But, speaking of needing it in combat, Grog considers the use in combat. The group's immediate reaction is that it takes too long to cast. It would be about 10 rounds to cast.
Yeah. They really need to prep that, yes. Which hopefully they realize they can do.
That would be one of those things. In the future. Yeah, they would need to, specifically with the dragons is what I was thinking when I was saying prep the battlefield. You're sneaking up or luring the dragon to you. So while you're in that little stealth window, cast it, and then charge the dragon. Fall back if you need to.
Yep. I like it.
So, at that point, Vax pops up with, "Is there anything else you can do? Can you make an army of unicorns or a giant in a dancing dress?" And I know that very few of the listeners will get this when I say this. Last week, I did a one-shot for one of my friends that we did broadcast, and it will be going up on my channel as soon as I get the editing done on it, because it's a 7-hour long thing.
Ooh, I'm excited. I want to see this.
Yes. And at one point, there was a giant who was throwing a dinner party.
Oh, no.
So the giant in the dancing dress comment just caught me off guard because it was so soon after the one shot, and I just had to pause for a moment, and I was like, wait, did Liam actually see the one shot?
Maybe.
I hope so. That'd be awesome. But
yeah,
I'm not narcissistic enough to think that it's actually possible. It caught me off guard. So Vex goes ahead and releases Trinket in the mansion. I call upon the power of Trinket. I choose you! She loves that.
I loved it, yeah.
It's awesome. So Vex asks Scanlan about a room with high ceilings for her and Trinket. Scanlan tells her about the training room in the basement after joking about maybe putting him in a cupboard. Grog volunteers to stay in the training area with Trinket. But before they head down, Grog requests a cow. He says to the five servants, the first one of you back with a cow wins. All five of the servants go off, and they all come back carrying one cow.
Yeah.
And then, so Grog reaches out, he touches the cow, and then he punches the cow. No blood drawn. So Grog punches the cow again, and there's still no blood, and the cow's, you know, trying to get away from him. And Grog is disappointed, so he sends the cow away. And I have no idea why he wanted the cow in the first place.
I don't either. I think, I was wondering if it was like trying to test if they could get him anything he wanted, and then when it was a spectral cow, he's trying to figure out whether it was real in any way, so he punched it.
That's possible, because
that's the only mental connection I can make with those series of events.
That would make sense, because I believe it was Liam.
Yeah,
Liam asked for the small squid.
Yes.
And
can you get me a squid?
Yes, and the servants replied with, no, we have limited resources, and we just happen to have the one cow.
Yeah. So, yeah, so that was odd, but
although that would be rather interesting had it been ruled that within the limits of what was outlined, you could have anything. I mean, I guess that is one way of ruling it. Yeah. So. So Vex and Grog go down to the training area with Trinket, and Vex has Trinket practice his cannonballs.
And once again, Vex's mind starts working. You can see she's got a plan.
While Grog is distracted by Trinket, Vex takes the broom to start trying to practice with it. Now, when she pulled it out of the bag of holding, you know, obviously Grog noticed that. But she played it off like, yeah, I'm just going to clean up a little bit.
I can imagine that's not normal for Vex to be a very, like, a cleaning type of person.
No, it's
doesn't
not.
Doesn't fit her character much, so I was like, oh, okay.
Especially being a ranger, she prefers to be outdoors. There's no sense in cleaning outdoors.
Yeah.
But as Vex is getting the broom out of the bag of holding, if you're watching the broadcast or the VOD or, you know, even watching it on the Geek and Sundry channel or website, when she's pulling it out, there's a ding. And it's Taliesin's tablet. I figured that out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's why he picked it up and was playing with it afterwards. It's because he realized what had happened, so he was clearing the message and turning off the sound.
But it was perfect.
It was perfectly timed.
She's holding it. Ah.
Like, if I didn't know better, I would have said that she had gotten with the sound guys before the show and said, hey, when I pull it out, hit the ding. And even then, it was timed even better than if she had done that.
So I want to take a moment here and pull out someone's post on Reddit Leotis Leotis on Reddit, you evil, evil man, posted, as an evil DM, as soon as Vex opened the bag of holding within the mansion, yet another extramental space would have opened up. He's referring to, there's another spell, a portal, I think.
So what he's referring to is if you place a portable hole
yes.
inside a bag of holding or vice versa, it creates a black hole.
Yeah. A rip in the astral plane.
Here's the difference. The way that the Magnificent Mansion works is it's not technically a different plane from the Prime Material plane. It's the Prime Material plane shifted slightly.
Kind of like Vax and Vax's father's place or town?
Sort of.
Right.
See, the difference is that Singorin actually traveled into the Feywild, which is a different plane. But it's not an extra dimensional plane.
Yeah.
And that's the difference.
Right.
The mansion is not considered an extra dimensional plane, whereas the inside of a bag of holding or the inside of a portable hole, they are. So that's why they work that way.
Well, that makes sense. But Leotis, Leotis, you're one evil DM, my friend.
Doing that to your players is the quickest way to make them never want to play with you again.
That'd be horrible, wouldn't it? You'd be like, you know what, man?
So Vex, after having gotten the broom out, tries to get the broom to work, but of course it doesn't. So she puts the broom back and heads upstairs, at which point Liam, you know, asks, can Scanlan cast sad trombone? Would have been great as she had, you know, was putting it away and all that, because it fit. So Vex goes upstairs and asks Keyleth about possibly identifying magic items. But Keyleth can't identify arcane magic because she uses nature magic.
Yeah.
So Vex is forced to resort to asking Scanlan.
She did not want to.
No, she didn't. But she played it off so well. Scanlan pops up with, should we retire to my room for this? And Vex gets sultry, wrapping him around her little finger. Why, yes, we should. And Scanlan makes it the little teenage noise.
You do that so well.
I have experience. So Keyleth, seeing that little exchange, picks up her plate and awkwardly leaves the area. Vex runs back downstairs to get the broom while Scanlan goes up to prepare his room for romance. Vex comes in and, with a little flirtation, gets information from Scanlan in order to learn more about the broom, and of course he obviously quickly figures out where the broom came from.
And also that he's not going to get any.
Yeah. he holds out hope up until he realizes, oh, flying broom.
I see.
So Scanlan makes an arcana check, looks at the runes, realizes that the broom needs a keyword. Does an investigation, and he finds a mundane phrase that's not part of the runes for the enchantment. But he can't read it because it's in archaic draconic. Eventually points out the phrase to Vex, and she can read draconic. So she says a phrase, and the broom flies.
And the phrase is...
Candle! Oh, yes. The translation for the phrase is the phonetic spelling for candle.
Oh, what does she say?
Pretty much.
And she didn't realize that she's going to have to now say that every single time she wants to fly.
But so the broom flies, she gets excited, she gives Scanlan a hug, and she practices flying around. After a little bit, she comes down, she thanks Scanlan. Scanlan says, "You're welcome, but you shouldn't have stolen that." And Vex immediately pops in with her own guilt that she'd been hinting at earlier. She's like, "Oh, I know, I'm such a horrible person." Scanlan says, "We should do something to repay him." And Vex says, I tried giving him dragon scales, but he wandered away. And there was some questions in the chat. When did she try? At the end of the previous episode, she actually checked with Grog to make sure that they had dragon scales in the bag of holding.
Yeah.
She got his attention, but kept getting interrupted. Or she got Gurn's attention and kept getting interrupted. So she did try, but he literally just wandered away.
Yeah.
So Scanlan replies, "If you can't help him, you're going to have to help someone else." And Vex says, it came across to me as just a little haughty, like she, putting on airs, that sort of thing. When she replies, "I will help as many as I can while I'm flying through the air." Scanlan quips back, "I will pick someone for you to help someday." Vex says, "That's a deal." Scanlan says, "I'm writing that down." So Vex replies, "What are you, a hag?" And then flies out of the room.
It was so good.
It was perfect comedic timing.
And I can't wait until Scanlan calls this in.
Oh, yeah. I'm just waiting for it.
Mm.
As she leaves, Marisha pops up with, "You're going to be one of those Segway assholes." And Travis responds, "Yes, totally. Segway asshole with an earpiece at Starbucks." And just to, as an aside, Percy and Keyleth are sitting and reading. Keyleth's studying her alchemy book, trying to improve her basic training that she's got in alchemy now. Percy pops up with, "We never talk anymore." And then the two of them proceed to sit in silence for a few minutes, which struck me as just hilarious.
That was great.
Because
it's true, they were so close at the start.
Yeah, they really were.
And there is that like rift now between them, but they're still... Yeah, I loved it.
And then, just to show that...
And they're just...
The characters are still comfortable with each other. They did the, a little bit further on the aside with Keyleth asking, "Did you feed the dog today? Or did you feed the dog?" And Percy asks, "Today?" So, but yes, Perseleth is long ago, but not forgotten.
Yeah, it was a good ship while it sailed.
Yep.
It may sail again.
So after that, everybody goes in and lays down to rest. But just after laying down, Sir Konas stops by Keyleth's room. And when he comes in, we see that he is regrowing his arm. And I'm jealous.
It's impressive.
It is. I wish I could do that. Fortunately, I haven't lost any limbs. But just I wish I could regrow them if I did. Sir Konas informs Keyleth that 4 years ago, a young outcast had come to Pyra. And according to Ashari tradition, they took her in. And that very recently, the young girl triggered the escape of Thordak. And Sir Konas reveals that the girl's name was Rashan. Which, of course, the cast realized pretty quickly was the name of the Green Dragon.
Yeah, instant connection.
Yep. So, you know, in case you guys aren't aware, dragons do have the self-polymorph ability, so that they can change into pretty much anything, but they tend to stick to humans because they are so versatile and not the longest lived of races. So
they don't particularly like to do it.
No, they don't. But when they do, they generally choose humans simply because if nobody ever sees that human again, nobody's going to question it.
Yep.
And in the Geek and Sundry chat, there was an individual by the name of Ghostworks who said, "A green dragon with fire magic? What are you planning, Mercer? The Rise of Tiamat?" One thing that I felt the need to bring that quote up is because what we're dealing with as far as releasing Thordak from the fire plane is planar magic. It does not imply, nor should be inferred, that there is an elemental affinity as a result.
Right.
It's just like when a wizard casts planar shift. They can choose any plane to go to. So, I mean, and that's essentially what happened. They used planar shift to open it, just as Keyleth used planar shift to close it.
Yeah.
So then we jumped over, after the conversation between Sirkonos and Keyleth, we jump over to Vax, who's having a nightmare. In the nightmare, he's falling towards what appears to be this tapestry. And just as he thinks he's going to smack into it, he slows down and stops just in front of it. The Raven Queen reaches around from behind him and grasps a glowing thread that seems to flash as though it has a beating heart. The Raven Queen says to him, "This is you, my champion. You are fate touched. The choice is yours. Rebirth or ruin? Maker or martyr? Conqueror, tyrant, or nothing?" After saying this, the Raven Queen plucks the thread, snapping it from the tapestry, and Vax falls down into nothing.
It was so powerful.
Indeed. Oh. And the way Matt chose the dichotomies that he did, the rebirth or ruin, the maker, yes, or the martyr, and then switched over into conqueror, tyrant, or nothing. A lot of there's negative connotations to the word conqueror.
And tyrant.
Well, tyrant actually has a negative denotation, where denotation is the dictionary meaning, connotation is the understood meaning.
Yeah.
Conqueror has a negative understood meaning, but is a very neutral dictionary meaning. It just means somebody who has overcome something, somebody who has defeated their enemies. So, conqueror is not necessarily a bad thing. It's just, it's been used in negative ways for so long that a lot of people have thought so.
So depending on context.
Very, very true. And it's a very neutral word, and coming from a very neutral goddess.
Yes. And I think the good part about all of this too is it emphasizes the fact that he isn't on a set path. He has choices that he can make, and it's really his choices now that go forward. So even though he's promised all of these things to the Raven Queen, he still has a choice.
Yes. Now, granted, she kind of made it clear that whether he likes it or not, he is her champion.
That's true. Ha ha.
But within that, there are choices.
Yes.
Very, if anybody has played Dragon Age, a very Kunari concept right there. The Kunari assign a station to each person according to their abilities and so forth. And so you are literally given from almost birth a role that dictates your life. But according to the Kun, which the Kunari follow, within that role, you have choices. So,
Yeah.
just a little tidbit that shows how weird my mind works. At that point, we switched over to Grog and his nightmare. His dream starts with him walking down a hall into a brightly lit arena with people cheering his name. Battle starts, and he pulls out Craven Edge, and he's just slaughtering. He can't see, but he can feel that people are falling underneath his blade. And when he has slain hundreds, the light clears, and he can see that he has slain farmers and innocents. And then he sees Pike among the dead.
Yeah. You could see Travis's face. Because he started off so gleeful. He's like, yeah, I'm, battling, and that's so cool. And then the moment Matt said, and you've killed all of these farmers, and then Pike is amongst them, and he just went,
He
his
says
expression.
farmers, and his expression freezes like, wait, what? And
Yeah.
then Pike, and his face falls. And over the pile of dead, his uncle Kevdak stands, and his herd comes in behind Kevdak, and they kneel before Grog. And he wants to scream, but in the dream, he can only laugh.
Oh.
Ugh. So, we'll get into exactly where that came from a little bit later, but nicely played, Mr. Mercer.
Matt. Yeah.
So the next morning comes, and they have breakfast of chicken and waffles. Vax is, of course, delighted. Keel is surprised because Scanlan has wine at the breakfast. And he also has mimosas. And then he says he also has milk from a cow with a broken nose.
Oh.
Poking fun at Travis. Vex gets curious and asks, "Can we leave stuff here? What happens to it?" And Scanlan says, "I don't know." And then looks over at Matt, and Matt just goes, "You've never tried it." Scanlan says, "Let's try it with trinkets." To which Vex just vehemently says, "No." So Scanlan responds, "The broom?" And Percy says, "The what?" So Scanlan, instead of answering the question directly, throws it into Vex's court. Says, "Vex, do you have something to tell everyone? They're going to see you use it sooner or later." And this is where I started looking at Scanlan, at least for this episode, in a very strange light, and I'll get to that later.
Oh, okay.
But I just wanted to mention that at this point, something seemed strange to me about this episode.
Ooh, yes.
So Vex just quickly responds with, "Guess what? I can fly A plus."
Woohoo!
And Keyleth is like, "What? I had a really weird night too. What happened?" And Vex tries to pick up on that, change the subject to what Keyleth went through, and Scanlan puts a stop to it with, "Nope."
Back to you.
So Vex semi-mumbles out, "I sort of kind of tricked Gurnan, I'm a terrible person." And Grog says, "You sort of swallowed that last bit." So Vex starts again. "I sort of, kind of, this is the worst, took something that wasn't mine. I mean, I was holding it and I slipped, and it sort of fell into the bag of holding. No, guys, that excuse doesn't work.
I hear that happens a lot. Happens to me all the time.
But Percy pops up with, "You stole from a candle maker." And Vex responds, "I stole from a necromancer." And Percy doesn't back down and just says, "Slash candle maker." Scanlan wants to bring a little family pressure in on it. And he says, "I think we should hear Vax's thoughts." Now, I don't know where exactly Sam was trying to go with this. But Vax is a rogue.
Yeah. I think Sam was definitely just trying to open it up to the entire party so that they could actually all have their opinions laid out on the table after last week's explosion over the matter. But you're right. He kind of threw a ball where he was hoping to get a little bit of tisk-tisk Vex to a guy who does tisk-tisk things all the time. And exactly. This is a conversation I would have loved to have had Vax actually at the table. So he was on Skype, for anyone who hasn't seen it yet. I'm not sure why you haven't seen it. You should go watch it and then come back.
Indeed.
But he was on Skype for this, and it kind of made it a bit detached as the conversation went by. But
indeed. Vax immediately, you know, as I said, he's a rogue.
Yeah.
He immediately pops up with, "I can't judge. I did my share in the past." And then Percy remembers the flying carpet. And he says, "To be fair, we did steal a flying carpet once."
Fair point.
Scanlan, who seems to have forgotten, or put it behind him at least, just questions, "Did we?" Keyleth is like, "We used that in an emergency." To which Grog said, "We commandeered it." If you haven't seen some of the pre-Critical Role stuff when it was just a private game, there is a video out there. I believe it's on Liam and Ashley's channels.
Yes. They do.
And it's where they actually get the flying carpet as they're trying to escape from Allura's collapsing tower. It's not really collapsing in the "it's going to be destroyed" sense, but in the "somebody triggered some sort of alarm and it started the security measure of closing in on itself."
With people still in it.
Yes.
And they had a chance to tell Allura a number of episodes back what had happened.
Oh, they had a number of chances.
They had many chances, and they never did so.
But, so, after that, Vax just says, "You know, none of us can judge you, Vexalia, but it does strike me as a little bit odd." To which Vex replies, "I wanted to return it." No, that's a lie. "I wanted to pay him for it, but he wandered off." And Keyleth shocked the heck out of me by asking, or by turning to Percy and saying, "What's your opinion, Percy? I think it's kind of funny."
I know!
And I had the same reaction Percy did. "You really want... Wait. You said what?"
I don't know if it's a good thing or if, like, this is her growing. I'm like, I was proud of her, but kind of concerned at the same time.
I mean, I don't know which side of the coin is going to land on when this little bit is done. Because I don't feel like there was, like, it actually concluded this episode as far as Keyleth's growth goes.
Yes.
But it was just, it was surreal.
She's a changing.
Yes.
I like it.
So Vex, you know, tries to prod Percy. "Percy, you can build things and make things wonderful." So Percy just boldly asks, "What is this thing? What did you steal?" And Vex brings out the broom, flying into the air. Vex, you know, eggs his sister on to show off a little bit. How about you shoot a couple arrows up there? So Keyleth just grabs a whole chicken and holds it over her head as a target.
So trusting, this girl.
Like, I get what she... I don't really get what that... She was so... She used to be so... She was known for being careful. And now yeah. She's taking that level of risk.
She's just like, fuck it.
So, Vex makes a dexterity check to stay on the broom without using her hands. And then makes an attack check with disadvantage.
We all hope Keyleth keeps her hands.
Yes. So, the dex check... Vex gets a 13, which barely passes, and then with disadvantage manages a 16 on the attack. The arrow nearly hits Keyleth's hands, but does score in the chicken, to which she hands off to Scanlan, who just starts eating it. Vax asks, "Can you do that again?" and throws a chicken into the air. He does the smart thing. Vex makes another dex check, gets a 13, and this time she has no chance with the attack.
And I like it too, because during the podcast during the show she was actually swaying from side to side on a chair.
Yes,
like the whole time she was on the broom she was really into it. It was great.
Absolutely. So, you know, Percy sees that and he goes, "This may be an engineering issue. Vex says, "Yes, Percy, can you build a seat on this?" So Percy starts sketching. And Keyleth pops up, and this is where I was like, okay, you know, Keyleth is normal. I'm not losing my mind. Keyleth pops up with, "Beyond being an engineering issue, this might be a greed issue first." And Vex, of course, getting defensive. "Really? How's that mimosa treating you?" And Keyleth responds with, "It's phenomenal. It's been a long few weeks. I don't care. We're never going to see Gurn again. I have so many other things to care about."
And she's back again.
Yes, and Scanlan picks up on this is the way she acted when she was day drunk. So he pops up. Oh no, she's day drunk again. Vex asks, "Are you drunk again?" Keyleth, "No, I don't care anymore." So Vex floats down. Keyleth says to her, "I just don't want you to die because of your greed. I don't care that you have..." And she motions to the broom. "You look amazing." Vex responds with, "I'm not afraid to die anymore. I've come to that realization. I've seen the other side."
That was impactful.
Yes. This exchange showed the perfect two responses to what happened to Vex.
Yeah.
Vex is like, okay, I've been through it once. I'll go through it again someday. I'm going to live until that happens.
Yeah. Yeah, she's living. She's taking every opportunity.
In a very greedy sort of fashion, but yes.
True.
Whereas Keyleth is like, oh my god, I lost a friend. I've lost the...
So many of her people.
She's lost a possible relationship in her in her eyes. She's lost the relationship with Vax.
Yeah.
She's at a point where she's shutting down because she has cared so much that the only way she feels she can recover is to not care at all.
Yeah.
And neither path really works, but she's learning. So that's when I realized, okay, so it is normal. It was just not quite how I thought it would happen, which is great. I love it when you know, stuff like that happens to characters I love.
Yeah.
So Keyleth responds with, "I'm glad you've come to terms with it. I don't know about the rest of us." And Percy just like, "I feel too guilty to tell her no. Because it's really, it was his fault. Yes, Vex's greed put her there. But she was checking for traps."
Anyone could have been there. Yeah, she was.
She
yeah.
was checking for traps, and Percy, pardon the pun, but it fits, Percy jumped the gun.
Yep.
So, Grog pops up with, it is pretty sweet flying around like that. And Keith's like, "I don't care about the broom." And Scanlan, you know, responds, "Keyleth Vex swore to me she'd only use the broom for good." And it's like they're focusing on the broom and ignoring what Keyleth actually is saying.
Yeah.
Vex pops up with, "I'm not going to steal anything while I'm on it." Percy, "Well, where would you
while
put
I'm
it?"
While I'm on it.
Yes, while she's on it. But, you know, Percy points out, "Where would you put it anyway?" So Keyleth just sighs, lets Vex be Vex, and says, "Just don't get in trouble, I guess." And Vex is like, "I will. I'm going to practice, and Percy's going to help me so I can stay stable on this." And Percy responds, "Yes, I may need some money, though." And Vex asks, "You're going to carry that on your back?" And Vex gets kind of snotty. "Yeah, maybe." Vex, "You look like a Byroden chimney sweep."
A really good looking one.
That was a thought that popped into my head, actually.
Bringing style back.
Yes. So Keyleth responds, "You came out on top this time. You may not be so lucky next time." And Vex just sort of is so wrapped up in, "Hey, I can fly now," she just ignores it and goes to start eating.
Yeah.
Keyleth says to the others, "I think she listened to me this time." Obviously being slightly sarcastic. Scanlan, you know, responds with, "I think you broke through to her." And Percy, seeing that Keyleth didn't push the issue as hard as she normally does, or
yes,
in such a way that she normally would, Percy very wisely points out that Keyleth is learning to let people be people. To which Keyleth says, "I don't care anymore." And Percy, knowing Keyleth, "Oh yes you do.
Oh yes you do." Those three lines were amazing.
Yes.
Because, yeah, I pointed out exactly what you thought about Keyleth, is that she's becoming, or she's trying to detach herself from caring so much. But I think deep down, we know that's not going to work.
Keyleth is one of those individuals that wears their heart on their sleeve.
Yes.
And those people, for their own sanity, cannot stop caring.
No.
As much as it may hurt. We just can't.
Yeah.
So, they decide that they need to figure out where to go next. And Sam, the one with the to-do list, forgot to bring it. But right after Sam mentions he forgot to bring it, Vex remembers Keyleth's comment about something weird. So Keyleth pops up, "Sir Konos stopped by my room." And Vex, "Aye, my brother. Cool? Cool."
And Vex gives like this look in Skype. It was perfect eye level.
Yes.
Right up to
And Keyleth clarifies, "No, he came as my elder. My respected elder. No shenanigans." So she relates the story that Sonos brought up about Raishan freeing Thordak. At the end of which, Scanlan asks, should we ask around to find out her other ruses? Keyless just goes, I'm not sure. To which Scanlan replies, got it. Trust no one. So, getting into where to go next, Scanlan brings up, Grog had some brass knuckles to get. And Grog just says, oh, there are other things to explore. Vex, you know, brings up that they need to talk to a Sphinx, a Sphinx's boyfriend. And as Keyleth is sort of bringing out what she remembers about all of it, she mistakes Ossissa for Odessa.
Easy mistake.
Easy, but, you know, in my neck of the woods, one is a Sphinx, the other is a city down in Texas.
Oh.
Yeah. So, for those that are familiar with American geography, we got a kick out of that. So the, you know, little bit of clarification on what they needed from the Sphinx, which of course was information. So they decide to discuss the order of importance on how they're going to handle things. Scanlan sort of pushes to confront Kevdak, and Grog tries to be smooth, tries to be nonchalant about it, but of course it's Grog, so you can tell he doesn't want to go.
Yeah. That dream, man.
Yes. They mention that, you know, or they, after going through the list, everything that is left is around Westron, but nobody mentioned that they wanted the airship again. So it's sort of an on-again, off-again obsession.
Yeah. And I suppose they'd be able to find one out there.
Well, no, they could just, you know, pop back over to Vasselheim.
And try to grab one.
Yeah.
They could have, yeah.
You know.
And they left Kima.
Kima is in Whitestone.
Whitestone, yeah.
Yes. And Kima just bluntly offered to get them one, but
yeah, no. Yeah.
So, you know, the group talking about how they need to go back to Westron. You know, they get a little bit further into Grog's backstory, why he was kicked out of the herd in the first place. You know, they talk about, you know, coming across Pike's grandfather, Wilhelm. He was just out grocery shopping, heading home. And, of course, Grog, you know, stood up for him. Yeah. And so
after thinking for a moment, I could wear him as a hat.
Yes, because that was his thing.
That was his thing, apparently. He loved to gut people and put them on his head. Not weird at all.
No, not at all. But, you know, after defying his uncle, Grog had to fight his cousin. And, of course, Grog being Grog, he beat his cousin. But then Kevdak beat him shitless.
Yeah. Which is interesting because later on we discuss about the honor system in his group, Wandering Herd. So just keep that in mind when we get to that discussion
An
interesting conflict there.
Oh, it's not really.
Okay.
And I'll explain why when we get down.
Yeah,
when
definitely.
We get down there. So Percy, you know, considers, hey, why don't we use the Hat of Disguise? And Grog's like, no. If I'm going to be there, I'm going to confront him. I just don't want to be there. He didn't outright say that, of course. Yeah. But that was the impression he was getting. And at this point, the tone of the conversation changes. Because Percy pops up with, you were giving the impression that you wanted to put this off. And Grog goes, I was I? Like, he's been challenged. And Percy's like, well, you were, but you're not anymore.
The change.
Yes. It's gone from being, yeah, let's do something else, to I've been challenged, let's get this done.
Yeah.
At least in terms of the conversation. Scanlan pops up with, if you're scared, we can go elsewhere. And Grog just glares at him, and the look on Travis's face. I couldn't tell the difference between somebody who is actually pissed and Travis at that point.
He plays Grog so well. Yes. It's scary. It is so scary.
So, of course, Scanlan seeing the glare, sorry, I will never say that again. And, you know, Grog's like, I want to go. I'm excited to go. We should go. You know what we need is the wolf. Of course, you know, to help them scent out the herd, you know, track the herd, because it is a nomadic tribe.
Yeah.
And at that point, I happened to look over at Matt. And then during my subsequent reviews of the episode, Matt has a resting doom face. Like, you know how you look at some people, they look angry, and that's called the resting bitch face?
Right.
Matt has the face that when his face is totally quote-unquote blank, and he's just resting, there's no real emotion to it, he looks like he's plotting someone's doom.
That, I know the exact expression you're talking about, too, and you're so right, actually. That is... It's like he's plotting something in that blank expression of just,
And for all we know, the reality of the situation is he's just zoning out or just listening to pick up on little details.
Yeah. We're just seeing this. We're seeing too much into it.
Yes.
He's just pulled too much crap on us now. We're always stressed.
Yes. Keyleth, you know, responds to Grog wanting to go get the wolf with, I could theoretically turn into a wolf to help us find things. And Grog takes it the adult way again. You can if you want to. I don't know how long it's been since he's seen a she-wolf.
Oh my god. I still remember the conversation they had back in the cave when they released the wolf. I was like, well, what would happen if I turned into a wolf? And it just went in, like, the wrong direction.
Yes. Oh, but, you know, back when Geek and Sundry was still showing the character intros, you know, Grog's got four things, well, he says three, but four things on his mind.
Yeah.
Wine. Or,
ale.
Hold on. Women, shiny things, fights, and ale.
Yeah.
It was the fights that I was having trouble with. Come on now. Akiva, get your mind together. It's Grog.
It's late. Really.
Then at that point, the party tries to determine the size of Grog's herd. And it devolves at the end to a Rakshasa.
How many fingers can you hold up?
Yes.
Because Grog can't count.
Pretty much. So there is a short discussion of the viability of stealing the knuckles. And Grog reveals that the penalty for theft within the herd is being opened up and used like an appetizer. Keyleth, essentially saying that they don't have a choice, you know, says that we need those vestiges. And Scanlan, being a strange voice of reason, like I said, anything dealing with Scanlan this episode just was strange.
It was amazing.
Yes, amazing, but strange.
And strange, yeah. There's something... It's... Everyone's characters have shifted.
Yes, but you know, I'll get into Scanlan specifically later.
I'm looking forward to it.
But Scanlan says, no matter where we go, we put ourselves in peril. It's just a question of which peril to face first. Vex mentions that Pike may want to join for the Western journey, which got me thinking, is Matt giving her behind the scenes XP in order to keep the level gap?
I do.
Close. And then, of course, I had the thought.
I would have kept boosting.
Well, yeah. And it's a really good idea to do so. Yeah. I mean, you know, let them fall behind a little bit so that they understand that, you know, being there gets them faster. But at the same time, don't let them fall so far behind that a challenge that is a breeze for the rest of the party kills them.
Yeah. For those who are running real life campaigns at home or on Roll20 or wherever you want to play them, you're going to come across that issue where you're going to have people in your party who can't make every single session. That's just a given. Real life comes into play. If they fall too far behind, it can impact the group negatively. So keeping them at a close level is good, but definitely reward those players who show up.
100%. Yes. Just remember, D&D is a game. Real life must come first. So while yes, reward those that show up, don't over penalize those who don't.
Yeah.
Unless they're just like, yeah, I don't feel like going.
Yeah, if
that's being a different matter.
Lazy and silly about it.
Yeah. But thinking about that whole level gap and all that also led me to the question of when is Blind Spot's season break? So I looked it up. Their season finale is currently slated for May 23rd. I don't know how long the editing and you know, the post-production stuff takes for a television show. So we may see her as early as, you know, the 15th or so, or the middle of April, maybe around the 1st, or even as late as the 15th of May.
Oh, I hope so.
So
I miss her so much.
Oh,
I miss
absolutely.
Her. She's so amazing.
Absolutely. But, yeah, so, if you're watching Blind Spot, mark your calendars, May 23rd is the season finale.
Mm-hmm.
And it was picked up for season 2.
Yay! Kind of yay.
Yes, partially.
Excited, yay. But not.
Yay, because Ashley's getting paid.
Yes!
Boo that she's missing Critical Role.
Yeah.
But that's okay. Real life comes first, everyone. So, Vox Machina decides that they're going to go closer to Westron rather than just jumping right into the middle of the Frostweald. Keyleth does warn of a dragon in the area. Marisha thinks it's Rashan. Matt recorrects her, or gives her a little bit of a correction that it's Umbrasil, the black dragon that she saw, not the green.
Yeah.
Grog points out that if they're outnumbered, it's not customary to fight head-on. That the battle will likely have to be a one-on-one. And Grog mentions that he would like a few extra credit items, just in case.
Still trying to put it off.
We find later that it's a good idea, but
yeah,
we'll get to the whole reason why in a few minutes. So the group decides that they are going to go, you know, find the Sphinx first. That is their goal. Allura handled looking it through the Cobalt Reserve, so there's really no need to follow up because it was looking pretty destroyed already. While they're talking about where in the Frostweald to go, they bring up the memory of that is where Grog got the Nymph's Heart.
Now you, I think, picked that up a couple of shows ago, podcasts ago, I think, with the mountain.
Was that
it you who made that connection?
So, the mountain, Gat Shadow, where Umbrasil is living right now, is part of that whole storyline.
Yeah.
Or that particular portion of the arc. Grog had been infused with essentially the soul gem of a lich. Okay. And in order to get it out, they needed to get these different items, like the heart of a nightmare, which was mentioned a little bit later in this episode. And they also needed a nymph's heart.
Yes.
Now, the way it was originally presented, at least in the recap, it was implied that they would have had to kill the nymph to get its heart. But Grog went in alone into the nymph's house. And there's sort of hinted, implied, Goliath nymph sexy times going on.
Yep.
But of course, Grog says, I don't kiss and tell. Vex calls him out on that. He's like, yeah, I do all the time, but I'm not this time.
So did the nymph give it freely?
Or not? Yes. Yes, she did. Okay. And I say that because when in the recap or the flashback comics that they did.
Yes.
Grog, you know, as they're leaving the nymph's house, she's standing in the doorway watching them go, and they're waving to each other.
Aha. Uh-huh.
So
I have to watch that again.
If she hadn't have given it freely, she would have been dead.
Sure.
So they look at their travel options on how they're going to get down to the Frostweald. And unfortunately, the last time they were in the Frostweald, they were so low level, Keyleth was not memorizing trees in order to use them as travel points.
Yeah.
So then their options are reduced to either just find some place close that she can remember, or scry to find a tree. It turns out that she remembers the trees at the crossroads, which is to the northwest of Westron. Trees in and around the Bramblewood Forest, which is north of Westron, or points that are much farther west and farther away. She settles on the Bramblewood, and when they get to the Bramblewood, when they pop out of the tree, they are in an area that is 1.5 to 2 days, depending on how you travel, whether it's horseback or force march, meaning, you know, as fast as you can, excuse me, on foot. They're about 1.5 to 2 days of travel to the Frostweald. And so she's like, or Keyleth is like, you know, I'm just going to go mist form. We'll go speed travel that way. They mist form, they're flying along, and as they get closer to Westron, they see what is quickly identified as the offering area, where the dragon is coming down to collect the gold and silver and gems and whatever else of value that can be found to be offered to the dragon. And it's just coming down, scooping it up, flying it back to Gat Shadow.
Good place to remember.
Indeed. And the fact that black dragons, more than any other, in my opinion and everything that I have read, tend to be more creatures of habit than any of the other chromatic dragons.
Right.
Really makes it for a good ambush point.
Nice. Yeah. With the mansion.
Yes.
And that's it.
Yes. They continue on a little ways at seeing, you know, some burned farms. And then they see some functional farms, and there are guards wandering around, keeping an eye on the farmers.
Yep. And this is where their plan starts to fall apart.
Yeah, I don't... Not so much fall apart as...
Get distracted.
We'll go with that. Get distracted. Okay. Don't get me wrong. They gained a lot of usable...
It was great. Yeah.
Usable worth information. What were you saying?
It was worth it.
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah.
Vax decides that he wants to investigate closer. So eventually all of Vox Machina lands in a high corn-like crop farmland where the stalks and all that are tall enough to hide them. Vex casts pass without a trace after they solidify, and the lowest stealth roll was a 25. And that was Vax before Vex reminded him to add 10.
Oh, wow.
To which, you know, Taliesin responds to Matt, "You don't even know we're here anymore. The players have just disappeared."
It's good rolls.
Yes. So Vex, you know, thinking about the situation, brings up that, you know, the farmers are essentially slave labor right now. And if they aren't out in the fields, the city may starve if they're set free without a plan on how to release the city as well. One of the farmers in the field comes close, and Grog gets his attention. And at first, I was thinking, oh good, Vex, we'll get to see Vex question him and see some nuances. But no, she just bluntly straight up asks him, "Do you like the dragon or no?"
Yep. No more bullshit.
I was waiting for a little bit of a back and forth.
Flirtation?
Not necessarily flirtation, but just her trying to get the information out without letting... Or trying to get the truth out without letting the farmer realize what exactly he was letting out.
Yeah.
But no, it's just blunt right there. So the farmer replies, "Hard to find around these parts anyone that likes a dragon. But that's not the worst of the worries, though." So Vex asks, "What's the worst?" The farmer responds, "The ones that work for him." Vex asks, "You have to provide for everyone in the city?" The farmer's like, "Yep, every one of them. Otherwise they steal from whatever's nearby. Hasn't been a caravan passed by Western in the past week." Of course, thinking about it, all of the major cities on that particular continent have been destroyed, so there's nowhere for a caravan to come from either.
Makes sense.
It turns out that the farmer's daughter is being held, and the farmer's name is Reginald.
So that is called a hook, dear players, when a DM or GM makes you want to actually investigate something further. You throw a hook in.
Yes.
And it's the daughter, the captive daughter.
Yes. And the way this is done is it's very well done, because it is right there out in the front, but at the same time the players have the option of walking away.
Yeah.
You want to make sure that the players feel that they have the freedom. Make sure that they understand that it is important and that they want to do this.
But never... what's the word for it when you only give them one path, one option?
Never put the story on rails.
Yes, rail them.
Yes.
I've been in campaigns like that, and they're horrible.
Now, it's different if you're running a campaign from a handout or an official campaign from Wizards of the Coast, because that's not a real world. That is a specific, singular story. You don't really have much of a choice, because you're not the one who made it.
Even official campaigns, though, if you can always take them, and expand them and be very flexible absolutely. With them as well.
Absolutely. Yeah. Use them as a base.
A guide.
Yes. It's like, you've got a map, there's a trail mark there, but you know what? I'm going to create a trail over here.
Yeah. And if your players want to go that direction, let them go and see what they find.
Indeed. So, you know, they ask about, or the Vox Machina asks Reggie about, you know, the dragon, how often it's seen. It turns out it patrols every few days. It was last seen about half a day ago, yesterday. But the Umbrasil does not have wyverns working for him. Keyleth, during the conversation, there are hints that dropped because Reggie does not straight up say, hey, we're dealing with Goliaths. Probably because there's a Goliath standing right there.
Yeah, he's quite open considering that fact. You would have thought that he would have seen the Goliath and went, but maybe because he was still stealth.
No, because it was actually Grog that got his attention, so the Goliath right. Barbarian was the first one he saw. But it was when the half-elf was the one doing the talking that he was That's like, okay, I'm going to be open with this. I'll take this risk.
Yeah.
What more can they do to me?
True.
But he avoids pointing out the Goliaths are the ones in charge. And Keyleth, putting together the clues of omission, figures out that it's the Goliath Barbarians working for the dragon. And Matt confirms it, and Travis immediately goes, oh, fuck me.
He was holding on to it. You could, because he was making that connection too, and you could see him sitting at the end of the table going,
no, seriously, please no,
seriously,
please no, please
seriously.
No.
And he's like, oh, fuck me.
Yep. And as soon as that reaction came out, Scanlon was like, well, sorry, we can't help you.
And that's that.
But, you know, Reggie sort of lets it out that most of the herd are in the city. And Grog wonders why, because they're barbarians, they're nomadic.
Yeah.
So Garg decides he wants to, or Garg, Grog decides he wants to question a guard. I'm reading too fast for my mouth.
Yes.
So the group goes a little closer to the edge and finds two guards, one of which is walking towards the city. Grog recognizes the one that's staying behind as Horace, who was nothing more than a punk kid when he knew him, and still, in Grog's eyes, looks like a little bitch. Keep in mind that a little bitch to Grog is still, you know, almost 7 feet tall and
muscly, and
his arms are about as big around as my chest.
Yeah.
So,
well, in the eye of the beholder.
Yes. So Vex pops up with a quick plan. You know, she's going to use hide in plain sight, have Reggie call for help, Horace will come in and they'll ambush him, and Grog loves it. So Vex takes a few minutes to camouflage everyone, because that's what hide in plain sight is. You are essentially using what's around you to blend into the background.
Yeah.
Now, we'll get into what it does mechanically in just a moment. So, Vex camouflages everybody. Keyleth readies Entangle. There's a little discussion about possibly making a trap, but Matt points out that would take a little bit of time. And they don't really have time at this point. So, Keyleth just readies the spell. Reggie, you know, moves a little bit further in and fakes an injury to his ankle. Horace gets pissed off, goes in after him. And once Horace has entered in, she casts her entangle. As soon as Percy says now, she casts it. And so a 20-foot area, as the spell description goes, a 20-foot area sprouts weeds and plants. In this case, Matt used the plants that were already there.
Yeah.
And the whoever goes through that area has to pass a strength check or they become grappled. And Horus failed so miserably that he's essentially immobilized.
Which was lucky.
Yes. The way Matt describes it is that the plants just sort of, you know, whip in and wrap around him. And Laura's like, oh shit, we're going to be seen. Matt clarifies that it's the inner area, not right on the edge of the farm. And, you know, everybody's like, oh good. You know, I thought it'd just be like all wavy and all that. And they start doing an imitation of the wacky, wavy, flailing, arm inflatable tube guy. I can never say that fast enough to make it actually funny, but I try.
Wacky, wavy, yeah.
Yeah, pretty much. So, Horus, you know, as I said, failed his save. And Grog immediately goes in and tackles him. And punches him in the face. Punches him in the face a second time. Hesitates and then punches him in the face a third time.
Mm-hmm.
When he tackled him, he had clamped his hand over Horace's mouth so that he couldn't yell out. After the third punch, he slightly lifts his hand and Horace is cursing, so he gets a fourth punch to the face. And then Grog just goes, Horus. And Horus recognizes who he is. And he goes limp. So Grog starts everything out with a warning. You be quiet, or else it's wash, rinse, repeat, yeah? And Horus nods. And Grog tries to play friendly with him, which I thought was very brilliant. Smart. Yes.
Yeah.
And, you know, Grog's like, you're looking big. And Horus is like, you're supposed to be dead. I watched you get beat to death. How are you still alive? Grog just goes, yeah, funny thing about me. So who else is out with you right now? Horus is like, no one. And Grog raises his fist like he knows he's lying.
Yeah.
And Horus is like, it's me and Cole, but Cole's heading back to the city. We have others spots around, but most stay in the city. That's where the festivities are. And stop me if I get unable to be understood with my attempt at Matt's amazing
accents.
Accent.
So good. You're doing well.
Thank you. So Vex asks Grog, festivities? Horus just continues on as if he didn't hear Vex or see her move or anything. Says, you want in? Now's the time. Grog's like, yeah, I do want in. But it's a bit of a surprise. You like a good surprise, yeah? And Horus, yeah. And Grog, I thought you might. Have you seen my cousin, Xanror? Is he in the city? Horus is just like, probably. And Grog asks, what about Kevdak? Horus is like, Kevdak stayed in the city as well. That sort of got mumbled. I couldn't even understand myself. Okay, no more accent for me. Sorry, guys. So, yeah, Horus responds, Kevdak stays in the city as well, at the old Margrave's place. Actually, turned it into his palace. You want me to take you? And at this point, Matt has everybody make a new stealth check.
Now, I wonder if he did another strength check at this point, too, because he never mentions it.
I think.
But you can actually strength check, sorry. Yeah. You can actually re-roll strength every action to try to break free.
Yes. But at this point, Grog was sitting on top of Horus.
So you think Matt just let it go?
I think Matt played it in that Horus was just so intimidated by Grog sitting on top of him that he was just like, I'm not even going to try. Not going to try.
Could be.
So they roll a new stealth check, and they still have the plus 10 from Pass Without a Trace. All the camouflaging, the hide in plain sight, gives them an additional plus 10. So Keyleth rolls, and she gets a natural 20 for a total of 47. Vex gets a 46, Percy gets a 43, and Matt just stops everybody right there. He just says, you guys have never been seen, ever. Retroactively, no one has ever seen you since birth.
It's just rewrite history.
Pretty much. Taliesin pops up. I could fire my gun at this point and people would think rain's coming.
That's so good.
Yes. Now, you know, Matt does clarify, bad news would still break it, but, you know, the pistol, a revolver. Yeah. So, Grog, you know, sort of covering why he's there, says, I was going to pounce the farmer and saw you were keeping an eye on him. Why are you doing that? And Horace, you know, replies that he thinks he's hiding gold. Brings up some of the things that Grog has done in the past and says, you know, maybe we should grab an arm and pull till he tells us. And Grog's like wishbone him, eh? You know, still trying to play along like he's sort of friendly. But immediately jumps back in with the interrogation. Let me ask you, why are you guys in the city? It's not really our thing to be in civilized places. So Horace spills the beans, and this was probably the most amount of single character exposition that Matt has ever done on Critical Role. Like, he may have done it back pre-Critical Role, but... you were saying something?
No, yes, keep going.
Oh, okay.
Exposition?
Yes. So Horace reveals, you know, we saw the dragons trash the city and then they left. If they didn't take the spoils, there were plenty of spoils left for us. More than we could dream of. The herd swelled a bit since you left, my friend. We conquered another tribe last year. Xanaror took the head of their leader and commanded them to follow us. We're about 100 strong these days. The cast hears that and they're like, oh god.
So much for counting on fingers, eh?
Yep. Horace continues, still Escalias at the top, eh? We took that moment, we rushed the town, and we took it before the day was over. Killed all who wouldn't bow down before Kevdak himself. Days of revelry afterward. Until one of them dragons came back. Killed a lot of us. 50 or 60 left before the anger finally stopped. And then Kevdak bent a knee and made an offering.
That surprised me.
That surprised Grog.
Yeah.
So, I mean, if Grog was surprised, obviously, that, wow. So Grog's like, yeah, Kevdak did? And Horace is like, I know, but you see a beast this size. It was a survival via mutual discussion, if you will. Promised our might to its worship. Gathered our spoils, delivered some every now and again. And we got to have leftovers. We rule the city in its stead. Not a bad deal. We live like kings here. Westron is now the property of the herd. And Grog is like, that sounds really good. Horace is like, you missed out. But we got some openings now. Kevdak be more than happy to have you back. And Grog's like, I actually brought a few gifts. And he unsheaths Craven Edge.
Oh.
I saw this coming a mile away. I'm sure did everybody you? Else did.
I wasn't sure if he was going to do it so blazingly, like, right there and then. But thinking back on it, there's no other way this could have gone.
Yeah. Hold on, I gotta sneeze.
Bless you.
Oh, I pinched my nose and it hurt.
Oh, no.
Okay.
Just let it be free.
Yes. So he unsheathes Craven Edge. Horus looks impressed. And then Grog asks openly, "Are you hungry?" And Horus is kind of confused by that question, not realizing that it's not meant for him.
Mm-hmm.
He goes, "It's been a half a day since I ate breakfast. Why? And then Grog executes Horus by shoving the blade between his ribs and up into his mouth. And everybody else is repulsed. Like, oh my god, that was gross.
I mean, he's pretty much just murdered someone that he grew up with.
Well, yes, but he also...
Right there and then.
You also have to realize, Grog realizes that his... Realizes now that his herd is evil.
I know. I know why he did it. It's just so... The impact of it is understandable.
Oh, yeah.
The rest of the group.
Mm. Oh, yeah. So he does that, and blood just starts pouring out of Horus's mouth, and Grog just goes, "Pity that. Acid reflux." And Vex moves forward and touches Grog's shoulder and says, "Good job there." And Travis plays it that Grog jumps, presumably because he lost track of them with that insane level of stealth.
Yeah. Suddenly a Vex appears.
Yeah. Now, just to let you guys know at home, in vanilla D&D, the difficulty actually caps at 30. So if a player rolls and they have enough bonuses to get a 30, nothing can find them. Nothing can hit them, or, you know, nothing can stop their hit. It caps at 30, and these guys were getting 46 and 47.
Yeah.
But anyway, so after he jumps, Matt describes how the blood is just sucked back in. Not by, you know, it leaking out of the body or whatever, but because Craven Edge is eating the blood. Vex sees that and just goes, "What the fuck is your sword, Grog?" So they start a little group discussion regarding if the sword is actually controlling Grog. And when Keyleth asks her questions, she makes a mistake of using the big words, which confuses Grog and ends up causing confusion within the discussion.
So good.
But, you know, they quickly move beyond that, and Grog suggests possible reconnaissance into the city, only to gather info.
Yeah. As clouds.
Well, they didn't quite get that far yet. They hide the body, you know, burying it and all that.
Yeah.
And then, you know, they discuss how to get in there, and that's when they decide to go in via the mists, in their mist form. And Grog says, "No, it feels cowardly. If I'm going in, I'm going in."
Yeah. And I like this because Grog is playing to his character, not to the game.
Yes.
Which is good.
And, you know, this, it gives another little hint on the Goliath sense of honor.
Yeah.
Or at least the barbarian sense of honor. So Scanlan decides that he and Grog will stay, and Grog surprises me by giving up some of his ale to a non-combatant.
That surprised me too. I'm glad I'm not the only one. It was a great moment.
Oh yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, it was just so bad of...
In the past, the only time we've ever seen Grog share ale is when somebody earned his respect through combat.
Yeah.
And now that Grog is in a situation where he's reminded of a time he lost, of a time he stood up for somebody who couldn't stand up for themselves.
Yeah.
Like, not just, you know, as a side effect, like with the Briarwoods, but physically putting themselves, putting himself between harm and an innocent.
Yeah.
I felt like that was a good callback there.
It was great.
And at that point, Matt calls break for the 10-minute bathroom break. And that came really late in the episode.
It did. We were all busting.
Yes.
We're like, come on. We really need to pee. We really need to pee.
I mean,
like the whole chat.
Yes. There. I felt like there were a good two or three opportunities for breaks earlier in the game. I'm not really sure why Matt waited so long.
Just engrossed, I guess.
I mean, it could be, but I mean,
his players are too good.
Like a half hour earlier, they had just arrived at the Bramblewood. Perfect time for a break because they hadn't gotten into anything new.
True.
But you know, it just struck me as odd.
Yeah, but we got there.
Yeah, we got there eventually. So, coming back from the break, we start off by, or with the recon party, the sneaking party. So they go in looking for, a crowd of prisoners, or, something they can get some information from. They roll their stealth checks, and nobody rolls anything lower than a 22.
Yeah, pretty good.
Yes. Excellent rolls. Stealth rolls specifically throughout this game or throughout this episode. As they get closer to the city, they see spears set up as a wall sort of thing, with heads placed upon them. They get into the city proper, and Western is mostly in ruins. Fortunately, some of the landmarks that from their past, that they're looking out for, are still standing. Pike's old home. The enchanter shop that saved them during their first Winter's Fest. And then throughout the street, they're seeing piles of burned wood and possibly trash. They look out over the worship district, and they see a few temples smashed, a lot of them damaged, but a good portion of them still standing. And then they turn and look at the Margrave's house. It is lined with row upon row of spears. It is intact, but very obviously defiled. At one point, Matt had said that the walls were splashed with maroon paint.
Yeah.
I couldn't help the thought, that's not paint.
I thought so too. Yeah. Let's find out.
We'll find out sooner or later. So they see 12 to 13 guards, only about 6 of which are apparently Goliaths. But they don't have enough information about Kevdak to confirm whether or not he's there or inside or whatever. But the information they do gather, it seems like it's their base of operation there. So they start to head back. While they're on their reconnaissance comes the most interesting part
of this
episode to me.
My ship came into dock. I was so happy.
So we cut back to Grog and Scanlan, and they're sitting there talking. Grog's like, "You and me are mates, right?" Scanlan's like, "The best." Grog asks, "Can I confide in you?" Of course, Scanlan just responds with, "I wasn't aware you knew what that word meant." So Grog tells Scanlan the nightmare he had, and starts telling him that he's starting to not trust Craven Edge, and then reveals that Craven talks to him. Grog decides to demonstrate when it appears that Scanlan doesn't immediately understand. So he pulls out Craven and says, "Craven Edge, how did you enjoy your snack?" And Craven responds, "It was a good snack. And a snack it was. If there's more, I would be so thankful." So Grog turns to Scanlan, "Did you hear that?" But of course, the Craven Edge's voice is inside Grog's head. Well, so Scanlan didn't hear it. Scanlan encourages him to try again. And Grog's like, "No, it's not worth it. Do you want to hold the sword?" And Scanlan's like, "Sure, good idea, actually."
I was actually really scared at this point.
So was I.
Yeah.
So Scanlan turns to Matt and asks, "Can I hold the sword? How big is it?" Matt describes it as a great sword. It's twice the length of Scanlan's body and weighs about as much as Scanlan. Scanlan asks Grog to hold the top part and he'll hold the handle. And as Grog starts to hand the sword over, he hesitates. And Craven says to Grog, "Only you are worthy of wielding me. You will hand me to no one." To which Grog replies, "Craven, I'm doubting myself. I'm seeing things." He turns to Scanlan. He's talking to me. He turns back to Craven. "I'm going to take you right back. I just want him to experience your glory." Great way to suck up to the yeah. intelligent weapon, by the way. So he makes a charisma check. Of course, he only rolls a 7, so he can't give the sword up.
Yeah.
Travis plays that by having Grog say, "On second thought, maybe I just need to see someone or talk to somebody. You don't hear it, right?" To which Scanlan, "I don't hear it, but maybe if you handed it to me, maybe I could." And, you know, Grog sheaths it. "Never mind, it's nothing. I'll go talk to somebody." And so Scanlan turns to Matt. "Do I believe him?"
I was so happy he didn't let it go.
Yes.
Like, come on, keep going. You got this.
Indeed. Because after the nightmare that was shown to Grog.
Yeah.
I was wrong in my earlier assessment about Craven just being dark.
Yep.
Yeah, Craven is evil.
There's something else.
Yes. Now, it is possible to have an intelligent weapon that's just dark and not evil.
Sure.
In this case, Craven is evil. So Scanlan rolls his insight check, and I get worried because it's only a 7.
Yeah.
And then Grog rolls his deception, and it's a 3.
And we all cheered, yes!
Yes. So Scanlan, seeing through the lie, "Grog, you want to give me the sword," and casts suggestion. So Grog has to make a wisdom save, or he follows through with the spell. And he rolls a 16. But Scanlan's spell DC is 18 without his hand cone. So it's a fail. So Grog's like, "That's a great idea!" And goes to hand it over. And just as Scanlan is grabbing the handle, Craven says, "No, only you can wield me."
And the battle is on.
Yes. So Grog has to make a charisma save again. And this time he rolls a 19. And passes. So he hands over Craven Edge, and I'm cheering.
Yeah, me too.
And Taliesin pops up with, "You ruin everything good. You take everything good away from us."
Because it was Taliesin who gave him the sword in the first place. He's loving it.
Oh, yeah.
But he's loving it.
Taliesin has always been one of those players that he tends towards the dark side. He enjoys the dark side.
He likes causing chaos.
Yes. So Scanlan, you know, holding it for a second, doesn't hear anything. He just says, well, it's heavy. And Grog's like, ask it a question. It'll talk right back. Scanlan pops up with, oi, Craven Edge, have you been talking to my friend Grog? Craven is silent for a long pause. And then sighs. If you truly wish to hold me in your grasp, I require you to prove to me your worthiness. And Grog asks, is it saying something? And Scanlan, of course, being Scanlan, says no. And Grog sort of panics for a second. No, it's not saying anything? So Scanlan talks to Craven. How do I prove I'm worthy? Which kind of confuses Grog a little bit. You can see it on Travis's face.
Yeah.
And Craven shifts to point at Reggie, who is a little distance off, picking food. And all Craven says is, prove to me. So Scanlan is like, I don't think I can. I don't think I want to. So he goes to try to give the sword back to Grog. Of course, he has to make a charisma check. And Sam rolls it, but he immediately asks, is this magic? Now, I don't play gnomes. I don't know people who like to play gnomes.
I love gnomes. I love playing gnomes.
So, for 5th edition, this was new to me. Matt responds with, it's not a spell. Let me check if you're referring to the gnomish racial capability. Right. Looking it up, it was gnome cunning. It is an advantage on intelligence, wisdom, and charisma checks, or saves, it's rather, magic. Versus magic. Not a specific spell, not a specific spell effect, magic.
Yeah.
So Matt said, this is coming from a magic entity, so I'll say yes. So Sam re-rolls with the advantage and gets a natural 20.
Didn't even need it. Oh yeah, well he did advantage.
Yeah. But Matt responds, you feel this entity has had a long life, has gone through many hands and taken many more lives, but it's never met a gnome like you, Scanlan Shorthalt. So Scanlan says to Grog, take this back, will you? So Grog takes it back. It talked to you, yeah? Scanlan, it did. You know, Grog, creepy as shit, yeah? Scanlan, it's very compelling. I don't know if you should have this, Grog. And Grog, of course, you know, being Grog, hold on. I just wanted to be sure I wasn't crazy. I mean, I'm glad we're sharing in this, but don't tell anyone. Promise me. Scanlan, all right. I won't tell anyone. Excuse me. But I might have to ask some questions about this. To which Grog replies, that's why I brought you in on this. You're smart. Scanlan asks, does it tell you to kill things a lot? To which Grog replies, what? No. Scanlan's like, I know it does. It just told me to kill something. And Grog tries playing it off. You must be a dark wizard. And Scanlan asks again, does it tell you to kill things? And Grog clarifies, technically, no. Craven Edge hasn't told him to kill things. It just says it's hungry.
That's because, true.
Because Grog understands that means kill something and feed it. Technicalities. So, at that point, Matt says to them, "You both hear a voice. Always hungry." And Scanlan's like, "Yeah, I heard that." And Grog gets excited. "You heard it that time? I feel like Kevin Costner in The Field of Dreams and you're James Earl Jones." And Scanlan...
"I have no idea."
"Yeah, I have no idea what that is."
"Neither did I."
"You don't?"
"No, I felt completely lost as well. I'm like, thank God I'm not the only one."
"Well, I guess it's just another look into that. Another way of showing that I'm just old."
"No." "Well, I'm uncultured."
No, I'm old. I want to say early 90s. Okay. There was a Kevin Costner film called Field of Dreams. And essentially, Kevin Costner's character heard a voice telling him, "If you build it, they will come." Now, Kevin Costner's character was a farmer. So he cut out a good portion of his cornfield and built a baseball diamond.
Oh.
And all these ghosts of the past greats, Babe Ruth, off the top of my head, I can't think of them all, but just all these old baseball greats, the legends of American baseball, come out, they just play baseball. People come and watch them. And eventually they all... move on.
Right.
Pass over, however you want to say it. But obviously I'm leaving out a lot of good detail, so...
I'll have to watch it.
Indeed. It is a good movie.
Okay.
But, you know, after Scanlan, it's like, "I have no idea what that is." Grog's like, "I have got a friend in this now." Scanlan reinforces that they should not tell the others about it because it's very strange. They might freak out. Scanlan says he'll ask Pike about it, find out if it's good, bad, or neutral, because I don't know anything about this. And Matt has him roll an Arcana check. Scanlan gets a 12, which is good enough to get some general information about intelligent weapons, but nothing about Craven Edge specifically. Scanlan, you know, says, "I'll do some investigating. In the meantime, try not to kill anyone in our party."
Yeah.
And Grog is just, "I would never."
I really like how Grog said, or called out Matt's voice with a sword as a sexy voice.
Yes.
Because it is, very sexy.
Like, I'm a straight man. I'm married. I would go gay just to hear that voice.
Oh, yeah. It's a good voice, Matt. Thanks. Not every single time. But yeah, just for Grog to actually say that out loud, or Travis, I should say, just made me laugh.
Yes. So Scanlan's just, you know, "Just keep this between us, like that time in Iman when we double teamed." And Grog's like, "The Eiffel Tower? Yep, gotcha."
Oh, God.
And Laura's face when they said that.
And then you have people in chat going, "What's the Eiffel Tower?" And it's like,
if you have to ask, you're too young to know.
Not the conversation for you.
Nope. We're not clarifying it here either.
No.
I will, however, say that had to have been some little backstory that they've just been waiting to spring on Laura just for her reaction.
Okay.
So Matt says, at this point, the mist dropped back in, and Marisha, who was barely paying attention, is like, "What, green lights?" And Matt's like, "No, the mist is you." And Marisha plays it off with a, "What? Oh, it's just me. Okay." So the recon reports what they saw. Vex asks, do we barge in? And Scanlan clarifies, if we go in, what's our mission? And Vex, you know, says, let's put it on the table what we're doing here. Kevdak has the knuckles. In a few days, a dragon's going to swing by. So it's not one problem, it's one large problem and a massive problem.
Yeah.
Which Grog agrees. There's a little bit of discussion on Kevdak's possible habits that would make him vulnerable. Does he go out to the offering site? Does he go here? Does he go there? And honestly, the party cannot see a reason why he would. There really is no reason why he would.
Yeah.
So Grog chimes in. As far as this city goes, there's two options. Stealth in and steal the knuckles, or I challenge Kevdak for the knuckles. Scanlan says we could, you know, catch that other guard. We could try a hostage. But they're barbarians, and Grog points out they won't care about a hostage.
No.
Keyleth asks, what would bring Kevdak out? And Percy, you know, responds, Grog. Grog would bring him out.
Yeah.
So Grog, you know, there's a little more conversation, but Grog brings up that his fear is that if it's anyone but Kevdak and Grog, everyone gets involved. Not just Vox Machina, but all 60 of them. And Grog doesn't think he walks out of that very well. He's not opposed to facing Kevdak head on and seeing what fate has in store for him while the rest, you know, frees prisoners or ransack his house. But Grog's pretty certain that Kevdak's going to have the knuckles on him. Keyleth pops up. You know, I just realized something. We passed over the part where I wanted to talk about the weirdness Scanlan? Of Scanlan.
Yeah, so, I was just thinking.
So let's just pause for a second, because we're also getting into the Goliath Barbarian honor that I wanted to talk about as well.
Yeah.
But going back to Scanlan for a moment. This episode, Scanlan became the moral center of the group. Vex, when she was, you know, like, oh, I stole. It was Scanlan that stepped up and said, I'll be your conscience.
Right.
When, you know, and then, you know, later on when, I can't remember the second part where I said that Scanlan was being weird.
At the table?
Oh, yes. At the breakfast table. And, you know, trying to rope Vax in on it.
Yeah.
And then again, with Grog dealing with the sword. Three instances where, as far as I could tell, for that brief, short amount of time, Scanlan was trying to be lawful good, and I thought the world had gone crazy.
I don't... okay, I see where you're going. The way I kind of felt those conversations headed was it's Scanlan giving friends advice.
No, I got that part of it.
Yeah. So he cares about them. I think if people he didn't care about so much came to him with those sorts of issues, he might have reacted a little differently and not really, like, gave any true care advice about it. But because these people have become his family, and even more so recently, I think he's starting to reach out to them a lot. He's asking Keyleth a lot of questions about, you know, where she came from and things like that, and showing he actually cares. In these instances as well, we're kind of seeing him progress in a way, not so much alignment wise, but in how much he really doesn't want to see any harm come to these people that he's grown to love.
Oh, very true.
Yeah, and it's, I love that. It's just, such a deeper, yeah.
It, in his own way, he, Scanlan is growing into the leader that he sees himself.
Yes.
And in her way, Keyleth is finding her leadership abilities
more balanced.
It's just the way it is balancing out is amazing.
Yeah, I agree. That is because he jokes about it all the time. He's like, oh, I'm the leader of the group. Well, and mate, you keep going the way you're going.
This episode, he really was.
Yeah.
So, but yes, going back into, you know, now getting towards the end here, you know, Grog had just laid his fear out on the table. Keyleth asks, is your herd the type that if you gain the upper hand over Kevdak, would the herd jump in to protect him? And Grog says, no.
Ah, so now we jump back to the start.
Now we jump back to the idea of the barbarian honor.
Yes.
It becomes, when it comes down to a one-on-one, you had brought up the confusion over Grog fighting his cousin.
Yes.
And then having to fight
his Kevdak. Uncle.
In the barbarian tribe, it would appear to me that Kevdak was grooming his son to become the new new herd leader. In order to challenge the leader, you have to work your way up the levels. You have to earn the right to challenge the leader. Grog earned that right by beating his cousin. And then he had to face the leader.
Oh.
So it wasn't out of dishonor or anything like that. It was, that's the hierarchy. Grog had to work his way up the hierarchy to get there.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
In this case, he's already worked through the hierarchy.
He's gone straight to the top.
Yes. So he no longer has to go through the hierarchy. Yeah, he was left for dead, but he survived. Which means,
yeah,
he retains the honor of having beaten the second in command.
Okay.
So now all that's left is the guy in charge. And if he beats the guy in charge, then he is obviously stronger than the guy in charge. Grog is the new leader.
And he inherits Westron?
I don't think, yay, so much he inherits Westron so much as he inherits the herd.
The problem.
Yes. But, you know, if you own the problem, you can fix the problem.
Sure. Bit of paint. New furniture.
Maroon, quote-unquote, paint.
Oh, God.
So, with that, the group, you know, continues their discussion a little bit. The details are a little muddy because they haven't really decided on anything other than, let's just wait until Pike is with us. Primarily because Westron was her home.
Yeah. And she can also bring some pretty amazing tools to buff him up.
Absolutely. So Vex turns to Reggie, reassures him, hey, Reggie, we are going to help you. Percy lets him know, hey, we're just going to go get some reinforcements. Vex says, you know, you may have to wait a while, but spread the word that hope is alive. We will find a way to beat this. And then Keyleth shows a little more of her shady side. And if anyone asks where Horace is, Reggie just says, I haven't seen him in days. Turns and spits on Horace's impromptu grave. Vox Machina resumes their mist form, and Matt ends the episode.
Ta-da!
Now, Is it just me, or did it seem like Matt received a sound cue? Specifically when the group that had been out scouting came back. It sounded like Matt got a sound cue that, hey, your time is coming to a close. Like, they're almost like they're getting a little more
Timing it.
Yeah. If so,
it was a perfectly timed episode, actually, now that I...
It was, and so was last episode.
Yes.
And I want to say the episode before it was as well. And if Geek and Sundry is enforcing that, I mean, yes, it's Geek and Sundry's channel.
Right.
We can't stop them. They have to pay for all of this. They have day jobs as well.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we can't stop them. We don't really have too much of a right to complain. But that's going to make things a little more difficult going forward.
Especially for Matt.
Yes.
He needs to wrap things up. Still on a point where it makes sense, but...
And if they're trying to stop in the middle of a combat?
Yeah. Surely they wouldn't. Surely they'd let them finish.
I don't know. Combats can go on kind of long. Yeah. And they have stopped in the middle of a combat before, but it was at the top of a round.
Yes. Well, that's always cool. Jumping into an episode right on the cusp of combat. So. That'd be interesting. Just keep an eye on that.
Indeed. The reason I worry about it is because Critical Role is Geek and Sundry's biggest draw.
True.
And if they are worried about their day jobs and that sort of thing, okay. Understandable. If they're just doing it to do it, they're doing a disservice to their fans and to the show.
Yeah. They might even be doing it for the cast.
If they're doing it for the cast, more power to them.
Yes. Because I know they get really tired
sometimes. The cast and crew, more power to them. Yeah. If that's the reason they're doing it. I just worry that they're doing it just to do it.
To be a show.
Yeah. If that's the case, then they're doing it as a disservice. If they are, however, doing it for their own health, doing it for their day jobs, real life comes first.
Yeah. 100%.
More power to them. But that brings us down to the end of our Gilmore's Glorious Gossip and into our DM's Corner for this week.
Ooh, I'll take a seat.
So this week, I've had an individual over on the YouTube channel ask, when a player has a character with a major flaw and they can't decide, or they want fate to decide the action of that character, what would be a good rating for a saving throw to determine which course of action they would take? Is it lazy of the player to do this, and/or annoying for the DM if they ask them to do it? Not like Wild Magic, where there's a mechanic in place, but for like Night Terrors or Schizophrenia or, you know, right, just something along those lines, where having to make that call comes down or becomes disruptive to the game.
Yeah.
Maybe. So I'll let you tackle it first.
Okay. I've actually been in this situation before, but it was me as a player, not as a DM. So this is interesting. So when I first played a druid, I love playing characters with flaws. It's my go-to. I love characters that are kind of screwed up in some way. So you'll notice Rin, in my character in Legends of Legacy, is actually quite self-destructive and screwed up in many ways. In a similar fashion, when I created my druid, I said to the DM, I want it so that every time she shapeshifts or turns into an animal, there's a chance that she doesn't change into what she wants. So roll a dice, and if she fails, you tell me what she turns into. So I could be aiming to be a cat, and then you roll a dice, and I fail, and I'm a rat. Right? Because she's not a very good druid. So I thought this would be quite funny, and for a couple of sessions it was. In fact, it led to quite a few very interesting battles where I was like actually wanting to be a cat, and he turned me into a rat. And I'm like, well, should I just own this or change back? After a while, though, it did become a bit disruptive, I noticed. And so I told the DM, look, she's been a druid for a while now. I'm at level 10. Can we just say that she's got a handle on it now? So I think that kind of stuff is really cool and can be fun, but just monitor it and remember that your characters can grow and progress and change.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, when, as a DM, I have characters, or I have players that want a flawed character or want a flaw, I am very upfront.
Yeah.
They will own that flaw.
Yes.
Don't put it on me. Because most of the time, and this is coming more from my experience within the White Wolf Gamings and the World of Darkness, Vampire the Masquerade, that sort of thing, where you can take flaws in order to get more points to build your character with.
Right.
But if you take a flaw, you own it.
Yeah, don't expect the DM to keep track of it.
Now, if you talk with your DM beforehand and they agree, go with it. But if you're going to take a flaw, be prepared to own it. If you want fate to decide, then I suggest write up a table. Think of different reactions or whatever that would fit within whatever your flaw is. You roll on the table. Make it a D100, come up with 10, 15, whatever, different reactions. Roll your D100, your percentile die, and choose based on that. Because that way, when you realize, I'm not having fun with this. This is not what I want from a character.
Yeah.
You can then work with your DM to grow out of it.
Yep.
So, it is a very tight balance. But if you're going to take this for your character, or if you are a DM and a player wants to take it for their character, make sure they understand the ramifications of it, and have them play it.
Don't shut them down.
Don't shut them down.
Never shut them down.
Yeah, exactly. Remember, yes and. But make sure that they understand the ramifications. If there's not a mechanic for it, and the player's coming to you, well, how would I do this? Work with them. Develop that mechanic so that they can make that roll themselves. Because it always means more when you're the one rolling the dice. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I'm with you.
All right, so that will do us for this weekend. Well, we're recording this on the weekend. You guys are seeing this on Monday, so I'll just say that that'll do us for this week.
It's so late for Akiva.
It's 1:30 in the morning for
me. Oh my god!
It is so worth it, guys. Thank you so much for stopping by and watching.
Yeah, we love having these conversations with you guys.
Absolutely. Continue to hit us up in the comments or on Twitter. You know, we love interacting with you guys. But if you enjoyed this episode, just dagger that like button and subscribe to catch us each week. Don't forget to send any of your D&D questions or tabletop questions in general, really.
Yeah.
You know, send those in to us using the hashtag DM's Corner on Twitter or commenting in the comments below. We'll see them either way, and we'll do our best to get them up here. If you want to submit art, and please submit art, we love your guys' art. if you submit it to us, that means that you are giving us permission to give you credit where credit is due. You guys are awesome. We love you guys.
Yep.
But if you want to submit art, contact us via Twitter. I'm at Akiva David, AKIVADAPHYDD.
And I'm Kitten Smitten G, KITTENSMITTENG at Twitter.
We hope you enjoyed, and until next week, kick back, relax, enjoy your game.